Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
Welcome. Algerian TV announced that four workers and nearly 30 other people were wounded in an explosion that occurred this evening at a natural gas plant in Skabka, east of the country. The Israeli army announced the death of one soldier and the wounding of another in a missile attack on a military bulldozer on the Lebanese border. Early today, Hezbollah confirmed that its fighters destroyed Israeli military equipment in the south of the country after it crossed national lines. Meanwhile, the Israeli Foreign Minister Silvan Shalom announced the wall currently being built by Israel in the West Bank may be changed in order to reach a peace agreement with the Palestinians. In a press conference in Jerusalem, Shalom confirmed that the security fence is a temporary measure that could be removed and thus does not carry any political implications. Meanwhile, the Israeli Army Chief of Staff, General Moshe Ya'alon, confirmed that the founder of the Hamas movement, Sheikh Ahmed Yassin, is considered a target for assassination operation. In other developments, a source of the Israeli Knesset said that Prime Minister Ariel Sharon warned members of the Knesset that conducting negotiations with Damascus will in the end mean giving up the Golan Heights, which Israel has occupied since 1967. In a quick visit to Damascus, the Saudi Foreign Minister Prince Saud al-Faisal met with Syrian President Bashar al-Assad to discuss and present ideas for development in the Arab League. In Cairo, al-Faisal criticized the United States campaign to pressure Syria and delivered a letter to President Assad from Crown Prince Abdullah bin Abdulaziz regarding both countries' cooperation on issue of discussion in the Arab world. An Afghani official says that 11 Afghanis, including 4 children and 3 women, were killed yesterday morning in an American bombing targeting a small city in the state of Erzigan in mid-southern Afghanistan. In new developments, Israeli Foreign Minister Silvan Shalom announced that the wall currently being built by Israel in the West Bank may be changed in order to reach a peace agreement with the Palestinians. In a press conference in Jerusalem, Shalom confirmed that the security fence is a temporary measure that could be removed and thus does not carry any political implication. Today, Ariel Sharon met with the Knesset Foreign Affairs and Defense Committees to make a statement on the issue of the wall, which will be examined by the International Court of Justice in The Hague.
Though Israeli Prime Minister Ariel Sharon admitted that the separating wall in the occupied West Bank will be damaging to the Palestinians, he will not change anything on the ground. Haaretz newspaper reported that Sharon is thinking about the possibility of changing the route of the wall in a way that will reduce the costs of constructing the fence without compromising security. International, American, and Palestinian pressure has been placed on Israel to change the route of the separating wall, which cuts off large areas of land from the West Bank, making it impossible for a Palestinian state to emerge next to Israel.
This wall must stop. They must stop building it because it undermines the roadmap. The question is not about public relations. The question is serious. It is very serious. In the past 10 years, we've never witnessed such a deteriorating situation and freezing of peace process as we are seeing now. There must be guarantees to stop the building of the wall in order for the peace process to revive. If it continues, that means the destruction of the roadmap and the idea of two-state solution.
The General Assembly of the United Nations passed a resolution to refer the issue of the wall to the International Court of Justice at The Hague. However, according to basic laws of the International Court, it will not be able to examine the case unless both sides accept a referral to the court. International lawyers advised Israel that it will not be able to defend the route of the wall the way it is. Meanwhile, the Israeli Knesset Foreign Affairs and Defense Committee invited Ariel Sharon to make statements on the issue of presenting the wall in front of the International Court of Justice. In the meantime, the issue of the wall was the central topic of discussion in a meeting held today by the Palestinian government in Ramallah, in addition to the latest developments in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip.
The leader of the Hamas movement, Sheikh Ahmed Yassin, reconfirmed that Israeli threats in his description have no meaning. However, they are indication of the surrender of the occupation forces to the blows of the resistance forces. Yassin's statements came before a demonstration by students who confirmed that any attempt to assassinate Sheikh Ahmed Yassin will result in severe retaliation.
In a new show of solidarity with the founder and leader of the Hamas movement, Sheikh Yassin, the Islamic Party, which is a student organization affiliated with the movement, organized a massive demonstration in support of Yassin after the Israeli government threatened to assassinate him. Demonstrators say that the assassination threat is unacceptable and any attempts to target the leader will have explosive repercussions worldwide.
Sheikh Ahmed Yassin is not only the head of the political wing of the Hamas movement, but he is also an Islamic and Arabic symbol who millions of people worldwide look up to. Therefore, threats against Sheikh Ahmed Yassin's life will add more fuel to the fire that has been lit in the region.
A large group of students from secondary schools, colleges and universities participated in the demonstration, raising pictures of Sheikh Yassin, repeating slogans supporting him and confirming that they will take the path of resistance and jihad.
All of us will sacrifice ourselves for the sake of our jihadi Sheikh. We sacrifice our bodies, our souls, our children, our women, our men and our sheikhs. Down with the Zionist entity and criminal Sharon. The threats will not even scare a young Palestinian child.
The demonstration started out in front of the headquarters of the Legislative Council and headed towards the home of Sheikh Yassin. He gave a speech to the demonstrators, praising them for their support, calling on them to continue their resistance. He confirmed that the Israeli threats are an indication of the failure of the occupation forces and have failed amid blows by the resistance.
These young men are the leaders of this battle. These young men have set a new precedent for martyrdom and jihad against this enemy who surrendered in front of the will of the Palestinian nation. Though the enemy wanted to force us to surrender, he ended up surrendering. Greetings to those young men, the believers, the patient and the jihadi, and to all the mujahideens in the world, God willing.
The Israeli deputy defense minister had threatened to assassinate Sheikh Yassin after the martyrdom operation at Beit Hanun crossing north of Gaza Strip, killing four Israeli soldiers. Students held this demonstration in solidarity of Sheikh Ahmed Yassin, the leader of the Hamas movement, clearly defying Israeli threats to assassinate him, and as a warning of what may come if Israel carries out its threats, Hazem Bidaro, the Gaza Strip. Dozens of American soldiers are now present in Iraq in one of the biggest military redeployment operations outside the U.S. since the Second World War. Redeployment operations are called several names, but in nature, they differ completely from military operations that were carried out during the Cold War. At the time, the U.S. depended on huge military bases and widely spread intelligence centers in Western Europe and some countries in Asia. Now, a continuous net of American bases throughout the world are being established under the banner of confronting crises and threats against American interests everywhere. In the aftermath of September 11, a number of American officials from the American administration and the Pentagon rushed to develop a national security strategy, which included the preemption doctrine to fight what Washington considers terrorism anywhere on earth. The objective was to prevent non-allied countries from acquiring weapons of mass destruction and thus enforcing the U.S. position as the only superpower country. It turned out that the occupation of Iraq might have been planned before the attacks on New York. Naturally, the American plan was developed on several levels. At the military level, American officials recently announced that American forces will be redeployed all over the world.
Everything will be moved everywhere. No place in the world will stay the way it used to be.
The words of Douglas Faith, Undersecretary of Defense, leads one to believe that the economic and political price tag for redeployment U.S. forces will be very expensive. Senior officials in the American administration put into place political and diplomatic plans to launch one of the largest redeployment operations in a half century. However, the Pentagon did not wait for these plans. About 350,000 American soldiers are now deployed in 130 countries around the globe. More than 100,000 of them are stationed in more than 150 military locations in Iraq. It seems that the Middle East will now take over the role that was once played by Western Europe or Eastern Asia during the Cold War. The new redeployment strategy will include 79 American military bases in the so-called Near East and African Horn. Also, there will be an intensified presence of large American military units in the Middle and Southern Asia, inside and around Afghanistan. These stations will cover 25 countries, stretching from Pakistan in the east to Morocco in the west. Americans refer to that region as the crescent of crisis.
والتي توصف أمنيا أيضا بهلال الأزمات.
Change will not be confined to the location of military bases. Rather, the type of deployed forces will also change. According to American newspapers, a select few Marines, special forces, and other soldiers will form a large percentage of the rotated forces. This is in agreement with the view held by American generals who believe that guerrilla warfare launched against Americans and their interests should be countered in the same manner. That is small units of American forces equipped with technologically advanced equipment will be used to counter insurgent operations, thus achieving the ideas of Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld, who called for transforming ordinary warfare into electronic wars, minimizing losses and duration. However, the absolute opposite is happening on the ground in Iraq. In our studio, we have General Safwat Al-Zayad, expert in strategic studies. Mr. General, Iraq is now the country with the largest American military presence. Why was this new redeployment developed? Does it have any relation to the war in Iraq and the way it unfolded?
It may be that this redeployment operation is the largest one in American history, exceeding even that of the Second World War. Now, waves of 130,000 soldiers and 110,000 soldiers are being rotated. From the perspective of the Americans and the American administration in particular, this war was a war of choice, not a war of necessity. Last week, we saw Paul O'Neill, the former Secretary of Treasury, and the Army War College, which is an important military school, criticizing the war. Richard Hart, a retired Army colonel, also wrote a famous article in the Washington Post saying that the Iraqi war was a war of choice. The American administration is weak, and the American president is now involved in a war of choice that was not necessary. There were other alternatives. Furthermore, the war is now becoming exhausting considering the death toll, injuries, and costs. So far, the cost of the war has reached $150 billion and close to 500 United States soldiers have been killed. This has created a situation where soldiers are no longer willing to serve in the Army voluntarily. In a congressional hearing, United States Army Chief of Staff Peter Shoemaker said that 9.3% are now refusing to volunteer again in the United States Army. From the perspective of Americans, if the percentage exceeds 6%, that means there is a problem. This explains why this rotational plan was developed. The objective was to improve the morale of soldiers, which has been deteriorating.
Thousands of Iraqi Shiite Muslims marched in Baghdad on Monday to demand an elected government as U.S. and Iraqi officials prepared to seek the U.N. Secretary General's endorsement of American plans for transferring power in Iraq. The demonstration in the center of the Iraqi capital was organized by Iraq's most influential Muslim Shiite cleric, Grand Ayatollah Sayyid Ali Sistani, who has rejected a U.S. formula for power transfer through a provisional legislature selected by 18 regional caucuses. Thousands of Iraqi Shiite Muslims staged a demonstration in the center of Baghdad Monday in support of demands by top cleric Grand Ayatollah Sayyid Ali Sistani for the US-led occupation to abandon power transfer plans in favor of full elections. The procession, incorporating representatives from all walks of Iraq's 15 million majority Muslim Shiite community, moved peacefully through the capital streets towards the city's Mustansiriya University.
If they want a legal government, even if it's a transitional government, the Iraqi people must play a key role in choosing it. Otherwise, this government will not have the support of the Iraqi people.
The protests came ahead of crucial talks in New York, at which U.S. occupation administrator in Iraq, Paul Bremer, is expected to urge the United Nations to help push forward his timetable for Iraqi sovereignty. Bremer is expected to ask UN Secretary General Kofi Annan to send a team to Iraq to convince Ayatollah Sayyid Ali Sistani to compromise on demands for direct elections ahead of the June 30th date for Iraqi sovereignty. Sistani has rejected the caucus system planned by the governing council and the occupation, which would lead to the creation of a transitional government but would not allow for polls until the end of the year 2005. Diplomats said a UN fact-finding team could either convince Sistani that the elections are not feasible or find a compromise that would avoid a showdown between the US-led occupation and the widely respected cleric. Meanwhile, over the border in Kuwait Monday, an advanced team of 39 Japanese self-defense force troops were mustering ahead of a deployment into Iraq as the vanguard of a 600-strong humanitarian mission, the country's first such venture since World War II. On the ground late Sunday, a bomb blew up in the holy city of Karbala, wounding 13 people outside the shrine of Abbas, in the latest in a string of attacks targeting a sectarian strife in the country. A sharp disagreement between Israel and Sweden over an art exhibit showing a Palestinian martyr turned into a full-scale diplomatic row when Israeli Prime Minister Ariel Sharon stepped into the fray. The dispute erupted Friday after Israel's ambassador to Sweden, Zvi Madzel, was thrown out of a Stockholm museum for vandalizing the display. The Swedish Foreign Ministry is to summon Madzel Monday, but Sharon said he thanked the ambassador for his actions. And the Swedish Foreign Ministry has said that it would summon Madzel on Monday to give an account of his conduct, which it described as unacceptable.
Reflecting a deepening rift with Europe, Israel's ambassador to Sweden, Zvi Madzel, received strong support in Israel on Sunday. After vandalizing a Stockholm art exhibit he misinterpreted as glorifying Palestinian martyrs. On Sunday, Israeli Prime Minister Ariel Sharon fully supported the ambassador's actions, which he said were a suitable response to what he called a rise of anti-Semitism across the whole world, and particularly in Europe, where this phenomenon is taking on dangerous proportions.
I think Ambassador Zvi Madzel behaved in an appropriate way. I think the phenomenon of anti-Semitism is so serious that it would have been out of the question not to have acted on the spot.
Not just right-wingers backed Madzel's reaction. Israeli Justice Minister Tommy Lapid noted that, though attacking the exhibit may not have been a prudent diplomatic move, he understood the impulse. Sweden's ambassador to Israel, Robert Rydberg, summoned to discuss the issue at the Foreign Ministry, said there was a misinterpretation of the piece of art, which rather condemns whom he called suicide bombers.
We had a good discussion with the ministry, and we will consider the different viewpoints presented by the ministry here. I understand that the whole problem is by and large based on a misunderstanding, based on a misinterpretation of a piece of art which may very well be in bad taste, very bad taste, but which is not a justification of suicide bombers. Quite the contrary.
The incident, widely reported in the Swedish media, occurred at the opening of the Making Differences exhibit, part of an upcoming international conference on genocide hosted by the Swedish government and in which Israel is scheduled to participate. On the video, an agitated Mazel is seen yanking a power cable to turn off the exhibit's lights and throwing a mounted spotlight at a boat with the name Snowit on its side and carrying a portrait of Hanadi Jaradat, the Palestinian martyr who bombed herself, killing 22 Israeli settlers in a restaurant last October. The Israeli ambassador has defended his actions, saying, quote, this is a monstrous glorification of suicide bombers, an incitement to genocide against the Israeli people. The expatriate Israeli artist who created Snow White in the Madness of Truth and his Swedish wife, said Mazel, missed the point of the exhibit.
It was very outrageous and I was disappointed in this kind of act that he is trying to hinder the freedom of speech and hinder the democratic rules in Sweden. He is guest in our country and if he don't like it, if you don't like the exhibition, he can go away. You know, this is what I think is the most important thing.
Israel has demanded that Sweden dismantle the installation, but its request has been refused. Swedish press reports said Israel further threatened to withdraw from the Stockholm International Forum Preventing Genocide Conference, which is to take place January 26, 28, with representatives from 60 countries in attendance.
U.S. presidential candidates stepped up criticism of President George W. Bush's Iraq policy, issuing scathing condemnations. They also hammered the administration for its handling of other foreign policy matters.
Democratic candidates for the U.S. presidency raced to get last-minute votes before Iowa on Monday becomes the first state to give a verdict on who should take on George W. Bush in this year's presidential election. The caucus has become a tight four-way battle between John Kerry, John Edwards, Howard Dean, and Dick Jeffart. Candidates spread out across the state seeking to sway the large number of undecided voters who could decide the contest and attack Bush's record, particularly the war against Iraq. While candidates have spent $8.7 million on airtime in Iowa since July, or an average of $100 a voter, some of those spots appear to have turned viewers off rather on. A poll published Sunday by Des Moines Register, the state's largest newspaper, put Kerry in the lead with 26%, followed by Edwards, Dean and Jeffart. However, according to the latest Zogby poll, Kerry was leading Dean by just one percentage point, with Jeffart and Edwards trailing the frontrunners with 19% and 18% respectively. Nearly all the candidates turned on the president's Iraq policy during their final speeches. Kerry hammered the administration for its handling of Iraq, as well as other foreign policy matters, while Edwards said the United States must internationalize the security force in Iraq. For his side, Jeffart said the entire military invasion of Iraq was a misadventure. The Missouri representative expanded on those remarks, calling for an independent investigation into the failure of inspectors to locate the weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, which were the U.S. justification for launching war against Iraq last year.
We now go to our reporter in Baghdad, Mohammed Al-Kazemi. Mohammed, good evening.
Good morning, Naji.
An explosion took place in front of the American forces headquarters. What is the latest toll of casualties?
According to medical and police sources, 35 people were killed and more than 130 others were injured. The number increased because some of the injured people died in hospitals, raising the number from 20 to 35, which illustrates the magnitude of the incident. It is considered the deadliest attack since the capture of Saddam Hussein. It is the third largest incident after the Najaf and the International Red Cross explosions.
لكن تصاعد حتى وصل إلى 35 قتيلاً وهذا يؤشر إلى مدى خطورة وكبر ذلك الحادث الذي يعتبر الأكبر من ناحية إسقاطه لعدد الجرحى منذ إلقاء القبض على الرئيس العراقي صدام حسين أو منذ الحوادث الكبيرة التي جرت في العراق ويعتبر ثالث أهم حادثين جرى في العراق منذ دخول القوات الأمريكية للآن.
This explosion took place outside the presidential palace. The area was very crowded, making it very difficult to transport the injured to hospitals. The American forces closed roads that led to the area of the incident, making the process even more difficult, despite the fact that the hospitals were in relatively close proximity. It took 3 hours to transport the victims. Of course, paramedics could not arrive at the scene quickly, making the situation worse.
بدت عملية صعبة جدا رغم أن المستشفيات كانت قريبة نسبيا إلا أن نقل الجرحى استمر لمدة 3 ساعات.
طيب محمد،
وسيارات الإسعاف بالتأكيد لم تصل بسرعة مما ساعد من أن الوضع يتأزم أكثر.
محمد، على ذكر قضية الإسعاف، هناك حديث عن عدم اهتمام أمريكي.
Some people are saying the Americans did not care about helping the injured, causing dozens of them to die. This explains why the death toll increased to 35 from 20, as the coalition forces announced in the beginning. What can you report on this regard?
كيف تنقل لنا مشاهداتك بهذا الخصوص؟
نعم ناجي، حقيقة حينما حدث الانفجار.
Yes Naji, when the explosion took place, American forces surrounded the area with barbed wire. US soldiers spread throughout the presidential palace, which is also known as the green area. They also closed most of the roads that led to the location of the incident in an attempt to protect their security. This kind of thing typically happens during explosions. Ordinary Iraqi people are the ones that transport the wounded in their personal cars to hospitals. Usually US forces are only concerned with their personal safety and do not spend any effort to protect citizens. All Iraqi eyewitnesses noticed that the American forces did not help transport the injured to hospitals.
لم تتدخل في عملية إخلاء الجرحى، كل ما هنالك كانت إجراءات أمنية الهدف منها إلقاء القبض على الجنات أو الحصول على معلومات تفيد.
The American troops only enforce security measures, trying to arrest the perpetrators or acquire information to aid in their arrest. US soldiers ignored the injured people who were lying in the streets. The Iraqi police and some citizens helped each other in order to transport the injured to the hospitals, but in the process, more vehicles added to the traffic. The roads were completely congested, making the transportation of the injured to the hospital very difficult. The traffic caused delays to ambulances arriving at the location of the incident.
Lebanese Hezbollah fighters killed an Israeli soldier and wounded another in an anti-tank missile attack on a military bulldozer on the border with Lebanon. The Israeli army said the bulldozer had crossed an Israeli security fence on the frontier but was operating short of the international border, clearing explosives planted by Hezbollah. In Beirut, Hezbollah said it scored a direct hit on an army tractor that had crossed into Lebanon. The attack could draw an Israeli military response against Lebanon or Syria. Israeli Prime Minister Ariel Sharon has warned parliament members today not to hold any negotiations with Syria. Sharon, in a meeting with the Committees of Foreign Affairs and Defense in the Knesset, said that any talks with Syria would lead to the return of the Golan Heights, occupied by Israel in the 1967 Arab-Israeli War, back to Syria. Sharon has reassured the committees that he is willing to negotiate with Syria without conditions once Syria stops supporting what he called terrorism. Last month, Syrian President Bashar al-Assad said that Damascus was willing to talk peace with Israel on one condition, which is the return of the Golan Heights. Her Majesty Queen Rania performed the lesser pilgrimage Umrah rituals and prayed at the Grand Mosque in the holy city of Mecca. The Queen returned to Amman after taking part in the Jeddah Economic Forum, which concluded today. The forum is widely recognized as the premier business gathering of the Middle East, which for the first time included sessions dedicated to issues of special interest to businesswomen.
Mosaic is made possible by a grant from the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, which promotes journalism excellence worldwide and invests in the vitality of 26 U.S. communities, and the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, Additional support is provided by the Fire Doll Foundation and Henry and Virgilia Dakin.